Hey everyone, it's Mitt. So in today's video, what I wanted to talk about is options trading. And the reason why I wanted to do this particular video is a few days back, I had done a video in terms of the frothiness in the stock market, and I'll include a link for that up above. But one of the callouts that I had basically mentioned was this notion about options trading, which has got a lot of risk associated with it. And some of the comments that I basically got was, hey Mitt, can you go a bit further in terms of what are the risks associated with options, right? So I thought it would be a useful time to do this video now, since the other video was released recently and it's basically fresh in people's minds. So before we get too far into it, this is a personal finance channel focused on helping you make smarter financial choices. So if that is of something of interest to you, definitely hit the subscribe button. Also ring the notification bell, as a notification bell will basically tell you when I release new videos. So without further ado, let's get into it. The average daily volumes on options contracts in 2020 has been significantly higher than in years past. There were almost 27 million in options contracts that were traded or exchanged hands in 2020, a significant rise to prior years. Now, there's multiple reasons for this. One of the biggest reasons being something like Robinhood, right? Robinhood has allowed people to engage in these types of contracts more easily, which is definitely a great thing from a liquidity perspective, right? But people just need to understand what it is that they're getting into and the risks associated with it. The other reason why it's gained a fair bit of prominence is, people are staying at home and they're having the chance or the ability to do some incremental research in terms of some of these more nuanced type of topics. And one of the prevailing features that you'll see as it relates to options is that you can basically execute on trades at a significantly cheaper cost, right? And when it comes to something like that, it can just naturally be a bit more attractive to lots of people, especially if they are unaware of some of the risks associated with it. So there's really two types of contracts and of options contracts, and that's just trying to keep it as simple as possible, okay? So there's call options and then there's put options. I'll spend most of this video just talking about call options because put options is essentially the inverse of call options. So what call options basically allows you to do, right? It gives you the right, okay? It gives you the right to buy a particular stock at a particular price, at a particular date. The key thing to note there, right, is the words that I've used, right? So I use the term right, right? It gives you the right to do something. You're not obligated to do it, okay? And it's gonna be very important to understand that subtle difference, right, as we get further into this. Because if you just have the right and you don't necessarily have the obligation to do something, it means that you don't necessarily need to execute upon it. One of the key things to note here, right, but in order to engage in an options contract, right, you will have to pay a premium, right? You'll have to pay a small fee or a small cost or a charge or whatever you want to call it. It's basically a premium is what you have to pay to engage or to make that options contract effectively effective. You know, the best way to think about it is really through an example. So say, for example, you have a stock that is significantly, it's got a significantly high price that you can't necessarily afford, right? So let's just take like Amazon as an example, right? It's over $3,000 a share, if you will. Now, at $3,000 a share, it's probably a little bit difficult for people to invest in a share of that stock. Now, I know there's fractional opportunities out there, but let's just take it at face value, right? That it's $3,000 and it's gonna be hard to effectively afford. So what happens with something like this is you can basically do an options contract, right? And so a call option, because if you're in the presumption that Amazon is essentially going to go up, right, or it's going to increase in value, what you could do is buy an options contract to buy Amazon at, like, say, $3,200 a share, right, because you expect in a call option that the value of the stock is essentially going to go up. So you're buying the call option now and you pay the premium on it. Let's just say for simplicity purposes that premium on it is like $5. Okay, so do you make this contract effective for $5? Such that you have the right to buy Amazon at $3,200 a share, like say 30 days from now, and it's trading at $3,000 a share. Okay, so that's what makes options kind of like an attractive proposition, if you will, right? Because you have the ability to just spend a couple of dollars, right? $5 in this particular example, if you will, right? To realize the benefits of Amazon 30 days from now, assuming it actually hits $3,200 a share. And now if it doesn't hit $3,200 a share, it does not mean that you need to execute upon that contract. You can just basically say that, you know what, I don't want to do this. I had the right, I don't have an obligation to do it, right? I'm just going to walk away. You can have the $5 that I paid from a premiums perspective, and I'm just going to walk away. That's what makes it rather attractive, right? So now, if, let's just say, for example, Amazon got to $3,300 a month from now, right? Now, what you would basically do is, in that case, you would exercise your option contract. Now you're only out the premium, right? You would effectively just buy and quickly sell the stock right away. And then you would essentially be able to pocket those gains, right? Without having all this money out of your pocket. So that's what makes options contracts so attractive to do, because you're only potentially out a few dollars. The one thing I don't want to get lost in all of this, okay? There may be some certain other fees associated with engaging in contracts outside of this, these premiums. And of course, you do have to pay taxes on this as well. Now, when it comes to puts, right? So as I mentioned, there's calls and then there's puts, right? So what puts basically allows you to do, or allows a trader to do, is basically sell a particular stock at a particular price at some point in the future. So you generally would use a put option for probably two things. You'd probably use it if you expect that the stock price to drop and you want to basically limit your losses, right? And the second reason you would probably do it is it's kind of a hedge, okay? So if you have call positions for a particular stock or some kind of an equity instrument for an extended period of time, right? And it's going to be of a substantial value, but then the stock starts dropping, you may have a put option. So you may have a call and a put on the same particular equity or financial instrument just to kind of like soften some of the blow from a losses perspective. Again, it's the right, it's not the obligation, right? So if you don't necessarily want to execute upon this, you don't have to, but you do have to pay the premium for it. So that's kind of like how calls and puts sort of work, right? The only risk associated with, it's very difficult to forecast where the stock market is going to be in the future. Okay, so I mean, if you could forecast where the stock market or where your particular equity is going to be in the future, everyone would be doing it, right? And you could, you would quit your jobs and you would just basically be buying stocks, and you would just know, hey, this is going to go up or this is going to go down. I just need to get the appropriate call or the appropriate put. And if it's just going to go up, I might just buy the equity and not even deal with the call. What you're getting out of that is that it's very difficult to predict exactly what the stock is going to be, right? So it's kind of like a bit like a roulette wheel, if you will, right? So if it's you're guessing on like black and red, right? So if you are able to guess black like every time, and it just, the ball basically lands on black, you know, you're going to make a significant amount of money, right? But what generally happens is that's not the case. And those premiums that we're talking about, right, on these call options or on these put options, they can start adding up, and they can start adding up substantially, okay? And people just start chasing the market. People start chasing their losses, and if they're not very careful about it, these premiums and these associated fees to enter into these contracts can get very, very expensive, and that's what creates the biggest issue for most investors. So that's the risk, right? And that's a description of what puts and calls really are. So, you know, it's really up to you to make the right financial choice for yourself, right? Generally, I would say that people stay away from puts and calls and, you know, just do some fundamental analysis in terms of what they think the stock should actually be worth. And if that stock is worth it, you know, they should just go ahead and buy it, as opposed to playing around with these games. So I hope you enjoyed the contents of this video. If you did, definitely hit the like button and subscribe to the channel as well, and I will see you soon.